to another edition of Facing the Nation. I am Malika Ramsey. Thank you very much for joining us. And of course, it's the first Friday in the month of February in the year of 2017. So we can see it seems as though we'll have another quick year. And if you're like me, you like things to go quickly, you'll be enjoying it. It is my pleasure to be in your homes again for another very informative hour. First off, and I did promise you last week, and I'm happy that I've been able to fulfill this promise. Actually, I should tell you that this young lady did confirm that she's going to be here way before last week. So it is my pleasure for the first time in about, I think it's 2 years, to welcome back to Facing the Nation, the First Lady of the Cooperative Republic of Guyana, Her Excellency, Mrs. Sandra Granger. Welcome back to Facing the Nation,
ma'am. Thank you very much, Malika. It's a pleasure to be here. And I think it was slightly less than 2 years.
It was less than 2 years?
Yes.
Okay. Well, you see, viewers, her math is probably better than mine. Okay. That's what's going to be happening in the first half of the program. We'll be talking about all the work that she would have done since she took office, the office of the First Lady, especially when it comes to uplifting and empowering our women and children in society. So that's what's happening on the first half. On the second half of the program, I must let you know that the Attorney General and Minister of Legal Affairs, the Honorable Basil Williams, held a press briefing, his second press briefing for the year earlier today, of course, hosted by yours truly. He touched on a number of issues that are currently making the news, including a recent trip he made to Jamaica. So you'll be hearing all about that because I have a clip from that press briefing. But for now, let's talk to Madam First Lady and the Office of the First Lady. You have been doing so much, and every time we see you, you're out in the fields. Most times we see you're out in the fields, and it's about the entrepreneurial and self-reliance workshop. Just so viewers who have not been following, you can get an understanding. What is the purpose of those workshops?
Well, the aim is basically to empower women, and it's called a self-reliance and success in business workshop, which really teaches women from the very basic level up how to run a business, which includes their paperwork and their, you know, knowing their product, their production processes, their communities, and the rest of it. And one of the components is that the participants decide on a project in their community. Every workshop has that. And we have had the women coming up with projects to clean up the community, to deal with adolescent pregnancy, to look at out-of-school youth. And I am very happy to say that we have held workshops in every single region of Guyana.
Thus far?
Yes, thus far. And we will be going back. I heard this morning that I'm going to get some funding to continue these workshops because we are aiming to go back to some of the regions where we didn't really get to reach the entire community. Because, for instance, Region 9 is huge, and we only did a workshop in Lethem, even though we had a spread of people from around the area. So we are aiming to go back to Region 9. We are hoping to do more projects in Region 4 because that's a huge population. And we have only done workshops at Lusignan and Kurukuru so far. So those are some of the projects we'll have for them. And we are also hoping to do a training of trainers workshop so that we'll bring women from the regions to Georgetown and give them an intensive week of training so they can go back and work in their communities. At the end of it, we are tracking their progress because we are creating a database that we will check to see how they are doing. Plus, they have the facility of being able to call on the facilitators from Interweave Solutions anytime when they have a problem. And Interweave helps them make contact with Ministry of Business, the Small Business Bureau. They give them ideas about how they must set up legally. You know, one of the first things they learn is you have to get a TIN, and you have to register your business, and then you proceed.
So it's basically a foundation that they're getting that would lead them toward lasting relationships.
And also success. Because I keep telling people that the data show that once women are sound financially, their entire family moves with them. And I teased some gentlemen at Linden at one of my workshops when they asked why they couldn't be join. And I said, you know, this is the reason I do it, but I could make you honorary women this week, and you can come to the workshop. And they came, and they enjoyed it. It's because it's basically a business workshop, but, you know, taking you through in detail how you should manage your business.
On the note of training the trainers, and you talked about having some of them even come to Georgetown and come to Region 4 and basically going to different areas, do you believe that this will also give them an opportunity to learn more about Guyana? Because what we find is that if you live you live your life, you even work in the hinterland or faraway communities, you don't necessarily know as much as you should know about other parts of your country. Do you believe that this is giving them an opportunity to learn?
I think that's part of it, but it's also giving them the greater opportunity of interacting with other participants and understanding how they think and possibly getting ideas for themselves. Okay. And also, that another thing too is that they develop a bond.
Yes.
This is a sisterhood where they can rely on each other and interact and ask questions, share experiences. So you're developing that sense of cohesion and coherence among them. So that is very positive for us. And I'm very happy to say with the last workshop, the one we held in Region 3 at Poudroyne, we passed the 400 mark in the women we trained. So I am very happy about that.
What was the intention in terms of the number?
We were not going for number. We were going for quality. I know in the initial stages there were comments that we should really have 100 people and more. Mm-hmm. And our decision was no. We want to be able to focus on the participants and their individual problems as well as the general issues that they will have and then take it from there. And we have had some very heartening results. I mean, I had one of the teenage mothers from Women Across Differences with which I work. She had trained as a cosmetologist. And she said, can I do this business workshop? And we said, of course. Another one teen mother wanted to see whether she should open a shop in her area because there was no shop, you know. So they came to the workshop. One of them locked up her small business for the week, and she came, and they interacted with other women from the community because we do not. While we were at Poudroyne, we had people from Perico and all the different areas of the West Bank. We are very careful to include people all the different villages. So there's a wide cross-section of people and experiences. We had quite a few retired teachers in the midst who were either running or wishing to set up their businesses, and even some administration staff who were interested.
Okay.
So they seem to have a good time of it.
One of the things you talked about a few moments ago is the fact that the projects that they took on were inside of their communities, inside of their own regions. Mm-hmm. How have you been able to, because I know His Excellency President David Granger is putting Guyana on the Green Initiative path, whereby we can benefit from protecting our own areas and our own space, because all of that, viewers, would fall under the Green Initiative path. How have you been able to incorporate the Green Initiative vision, the Green Initiative policy into your programs?
Well, the thing is that there is a lot of interest among the women in business in using local products, and there is this resurgence of interest in using things like coconut oil and crab oil. And on that West Coast, there's a woman who's using coconut oil to make hair care products. I know at Linden, there's another young lady who is using coconut oil as well to make different kinds of products. And of course, in the Rupununi, and things that we knew as children, like crab oil, have made a resurgence. We also have small business owners who are going back to producing the things we know and love, like coconut biscuits. There's a young lady at Potentia who met me separately. She wasn't at the workshop, who's doing pretty good. And we've also met other people in other parts of the country who are going back to producing agricultural products in their areas. And we were encouraging them to use the skills. You know, when we were in Anna Regina, you know, I remarked to one of the ladies who was doing preserved fruits, I said, you know, why don't you use some of the kids with IT skills to help you make pretty labels and do all the things you need to put on your label, including your name, address, and contact information. And so you get a better looking product, say, rather than just a plastic bag, you know. So I understand Small Business Bureau is willing to help them in their packaging and marketing of the product. So that helps them too.
First Lady, and all of this is in your alley. The new administration, meaning that, yes, we're still calling it New Bureau,
yes.
APNU, AFC administration, brought with it a number of changes, including strengthening the education sector, which I know you're also, like His Excellency, a big champion for the cause of education. They brought with it strengthening the education sector, empowering women, protecting our girls and boys. Do you find that these somewhat new initiatives have been able to contribute or work towards strengthening the family unit?
Well, if a woman is struggling to provide food for her family, it's very difficult for her to spend time with her children. It's very difficult for her to focus on the things that we would think are normal if you're basically struggling to survive from day to day. And I think what we need to do as well is not only look at strengthening our families, but strengthening our communities so that there's always a support system around those kids and those women and our seniors. So that if it's being a good neighbor in a sense and taking an interest. For instance, you mentioned my education projects, and I have right now two youth, what we call a youth initiative, in Buxton and Lusignan. We have over 180 children in the Buxton Friendship area and 90 in the Lusignan area, because there's just one school there, whereas there are three in Buxton. And what we found, we got the parents to buy in, because we asked them, would you want your child to do this project? And the parents were very interested. And the retired teachers and everybody else were very interested. And it was really very heartening for me at the end of the last school year, because we started in Buxton as the pilot, for parents to get up and tell us, you know, you work miracles. My daughter began grade 4 and she couldn't read. And now I have to beg her to stop reading. She's reading everything on the TV and the news. You know, it was funny, but at the same time, you felt that there was an impact in the community.
Exactly. The tree achieved a lot.
Yes, so that was one of the things. And you saw, for me, it was going back to that old idea of Buxton being a village that always put a priority on education. Because some of the retired teachers were saying, you know, we could do something for the secondary school children and help them in the various subjects and so on. So those are some of the benefits. I think if the parents do not have to worry about their kids, I mean, I'm being realistic. I know there are parents who might have to go and work somewhere, you know, but women always want better for the kids.
Yes.
If a woman has a primary education, she wants to push her children through secondary at least. She wants them to move. So when we get this interest from the parents, it really helps us to kind of focus some more and push forward. Unfortunately, my budget only stretches to two projects, but I am very fortunate in my collaborations with some ministers to be able to do the other projects that I have been interested in doing. We have also had an ICT workshop for out-of-school and adolescent youth. Last year, it was at Victoria, for Youth of Victoria, so we had some glitches. And Buxton Friendship made themselves available, and the kids were able to move there and complete their workshop and be certified. Because the other thing I feel very strongly about is when we you know, carry out this training, the participants must have what I call a bankable certificate, that it is recognized, they can get a job with it and so on.
So it's not just like another workshop or another workshop.
It's not just a piece of paper.
Okay. Okay. I'd like to stay on the note of achievement here, and mm-hmm. I'm trying my very best to quote mm-hmm. the First Lady. The last time we spoke on live television, you spoke about the fact that you were desirous of seeing our citizens improve their lot both economically and mm-hmm. physically. Given all that you've said, are we closer to improving those lots, I should say?
Malika, you're asking me a difficult question because I cannot answer without data before me, and this is something I have a difficulty with.
Okay.
Just to get up-to-date data on which to base my evaluations and so on. And I hope that, with computer programming and all the rest of it, Guyana should be able in the near future to produce data, perhaps on a monthly basis, so mm-hmm. that we always know where we are in social and economic terms. I think there has been improvement in some sense. In one sense, is that the women are much more confident mm-hmm. at the end of the training. The women believe in themselves, and they believe they can do things, and they know that their support, if they stumble a bit, they can call and get some advice. I can't say that it is real in economic terms because, as I said, I don't have the data. But I think the great thing for me is to see women recognize that they have skills. Because mm-hmm. one of the things that frustrated me at first was I would meet women and they say, well, I don't do anything. Mm. When they're running a house, selling at the market, looking after their children. I said, or one lady said, well, I don't do anything because I had to stay home and look after my parents. So I said, well, you're an expert in caring for the elderly. And, simple things like that. And, we got a lot of them talk out. I think, too, in my work with teenage mothers, I have seen those young women develop and grow mm-hmm. and begin to see the possibilities for themselves. Because, last year, Republic Bank supports a program with women across differences where they counsel and train teen mothers to, in life skills, if they want education, we help them go back to school, finish the CXCs. There were two students at UG who graduated with diplomas in social work. There's another one doing communications. We have some of them trained as cosmetologists and all sorts of things. And I teased them. I said, you must start thinking about the big money trades like electrician, plumber, mason. Yeah. I said, you get a lot of money there. So think about these things. Think outside the box and you could get there. Mm-hmm. But, as I refer to the girl, the cosmetologist, who set up her own little business and wanted to understand how she could best manage it. So they're thinking. We have some girls doing CXC this year, and they're not thinking, okay, I'm just going to finish this. One of them says, I want to be a lawyer.
They're going for the, okay,
yeah.
So it
might not be something you're seeing in a material sense, but that belief that I can aspire and I can go further and higher is what does it for me. And I think a lot of young people, when they do that, and they also learn how to deal with their kids, because remember, these are children,
yes.
who would have had children. So they're learning how to speak to them and deal with them and so on.
Okay.
It's not a simple life for them, for many of them, but they're moving on and moving upward, and that is the big thing.
And I know you're very passionate about trying to help as much as you possibly can with the little funds, which will come to funds in a bit. Viewers, if you're now tuning in, this is Facing the Nation. Today I am chatting with the First Lady of the Cooperative Republic of Guyana, Her Excellency Mrs. Sandra Granger. I almost said Brigadier Granger there. Of course, we're talking about her work, the work of the Office of the First Lady thus far since she has taken office. And you can hear from now that she has indeed, and the office would have indeed achieved a lot. First Lady, apart from traveling around Guyana, doing a lot of traveling around Guyana, you've done a fair amount of traveling, international travel, overseas travel. And I know you have met with groups of women in various countries that you would have visited. Are you able to incorporate anything, whether it be finance experience, from those meetings with those groups into not only our own programs and workshops and so on, but generally that we can use here in Guyana to continue to empower and uplift our women?
Well, in my meetings outside of Guyana, at the official level, I'm a member of the CARICOM First Ladies Roundtable on Reducing Adolescent Pregnancy in the Caribbean. And we are focusing on an initiative of the former UN Secretary General, Ban Ki-moon, which was Every Woman, Every Child. And our initiative is called Every Caribbean Woman, Every Caribbean Child. Last September, I was invited to make a presentation to the annual meeting of the Clinton Global Initiative on Every Caribbean Woman, Every Caribbean Child with Prime Minister Harris of St. Kitts, who is the lead CARICOM head on health and HIV/AIDS, and Minister Kamina Johnson, Minister of Foreign Affairs and Foreign Trade, who had done a lot of work with youth in Jamaica before. So the three of us made a presentation, and we were able to get commitments from three groups, which amounted to about 1.5 million. Now, this is a regional project, and we are looking at reducing teen pregnancy, dealing with cervical cancer, addressing HIV/AIDS, and in particular, mother-to-child transmission. So there's three things there. We're also looking at the prevalence of domestic violence. And it is shameful that we in Guyana have one of the highest rates of domestic violence in the CARICOM region, and that the Caribbean has the second highest rate of domestic violence, of teenage pregnancy after sub-Saharan Africa. So we are really dealing with major issues which require a cultural repositioning. And I think it's something that we need to go more aggressively after. Don't make it a joke when a man is beating up a woman. You got to say, you know, this is not acceptable. Do not do it, you know. So, and, you know, people tend even to joke to say, you know, sometimes a couple might be there and the girl does something and the man will say, girl, don't make me come put two bucks in you. That is not a joke.
It's not funny.
But they think it's funny because our culture
allows
people to look at it. I mean, how many times would you have seen a man beating a woman on the road and people passing and say, yeah, man, dash two more coffee and shit.
Yeah, and that's the thing. You walk away laughing. So many people are guilty of it.
So we have to really start to say, this is very damaging because it gives our girls an image that they are there to be beaten and they deserve it. Nobody deserves it. And this is where we must start putting our feet down and standing up and saying, this is not acceptable behavior in modern Guyana.
Madam First Lady, do you think we have... I mean, it will take a lot. You did just say it's a culture change. Because I can recall hearing an older woman said, man, it's not now men killing women in Guyana. It's years now. It's since I small. I mean, this is just a Creolese term. It's since I small, I seen it. What would it really take for us to move away from that, because clearly from listening to her we have accepted it as part of our culture, unfortunately. I can't even believe I'm saying that, but what would it take?
I think what we need to have stern laws which are strictly enforced. One of the things that when I was doing a paper on domestic violence last year, I think it was for Rotary, one of the Rotary clubs, it struck me that our laws deal with the issues after the effect, after a woman has been assaulted. The second thing is that cases are often dropped if the woman, as I would say, catch religion, and she go back and say, oh, I don't want to press the charges no more. My view is if once the charges have been laid, the case must be prosecuted, right? You don't want her to go and hear the police say, Maya, I'll go home and settle it out. If the policeman does not investigate, he or she must be prosecuted. We must show that we are very serious about the protection of any victim. I would say women and girls, but I know some men are also abused. And then the other thing, too, is that we have to recognize it is not only an issue of physical violence. There's also psychological violence. When you have somebody beating down on you and saying you're useless or you don't bring money in the house, so you're worth nothing. And this happens at all levels of our society. It's not poor people alone. It happens from high to low. It happens in cities and rural areas. So we have to, as you say, start re-educating our kids. And for me, I think we need to also look at how we socialize our boys. That, you know, you can't tell them, well, you know, you do this, this is macho. You say, this is what a real man does. Right? Maybe. So these are things, I have two girl children, I feel very passionately about these things.
Yes, I can see, I can tell as you always are passionate about protecting, you know, the ones close to you and your friends and so on. Madam First Lady, I have to begin to wrap up today's discussion.
That's fine, thank you.
You are very welcome. What can Guyana, especially our women, girls, and even our young boys, look forward to expecting and you did correct me when I said it's about 2 years, but viewers, it has been exactly 21 months since she's been on Facing the Nation. When I invite you back here after another
2 years,
say, 2 years, 20 months, maybe sooner, what can we look forward to from your office, the office of the First Lady? And sometimes I look at when we get these various briefings, well, the First Lady has gone here this week, she's there tomorrow, she's here next week. Sometimes I wonder if you can keep that energy going, because it's a lot of traveling that you're doing. And you did say earlier that you're going to be going back to some of the regions you've already visited. That aside, what can we expect from your office, if not through these self-reliance workshops and other programs?
Well, I have to say, based on receiving any resources, I've put out my requests.
Okay.
And I have to admit, I have had some positive results. We are hoping to continue, as I said, with the workshops on self-reliance and success in business, mainly for women.
Okay.
We are going to continue. I've been assured that I should put in for my workshops in caring for the elderly. We're looking at two of those, and caring for children. Because I really think also we should look at expanding into the communities of to ensure that we have certified caregivers for our seniors and our children. We are also working with our teen mothers, continuing to have glam days at the senior citizens' home. And last year we were very, I don't want to say entertained, because the men might get upset, because we went to the Palms just before Independence, and they glammed up all the ladies, and some women in the diaspora contributed toiletries, and another person got sheet sets for them, the women. And the men were saying, well, what's wrong with us? How come nobody come in to massage them and things? So I spoke to Pastor Sean Sobers, who organized some young barbers, because the girls who could cut hair said, you know, we don't know how to cut men's hair. They didn't want to do anything wrong. So he organized some young men who were barbers, and they went and they cut up the gentleman's hair, and the girls gave them the massages and the manicures and pedicures. So they were quite happy, and Minister Lawrence contributed some night wear for them. So they got pajamas and the ladies got thing. And we tried to do the gents as close to Father's Day as possible.
Okay.
So they had a good time, and we went to other senior citizens' homes as well. And the girls quite enjoy those interactions with the older people. So we're going to do some more of that. Well, I do also want to continue with the ICT workshops for young people. And we're hoping to have two of those. My Buxton and Lusignan Youth Development Initiatives will continue. That's where my budget goes. And we have other activities planned for senior citizens, which is basically organized by the Luminous Woman Group, which is a casual group of which I'm a member. And basically also other assistance. And I will accept invitations to speak locally and abroad. So When I checked it last year, I said I accepted invitations to speak at over 4 to 5 different.
Wow! So you have another busy,
hectic year.
Hectic year ahead.
Please, I also want to say that when Prince Harry of Wales came, he asked me to organize a meeting with our teen mothers and girls who had been trafficked, and he had a very good informal session. I have to say that the media were very good about it, because I told them I do not want pictures of these girls. I said you could take Prince Harry's face in any direction, but do not take photographs of these girls, because some of the trafficked girls are still in court, and so you
they're
want
vulnerable.
To protect them. Yeah. So, I mean, and he was very impressed with them and what they are doing, because he, you know, spent time asking each one of them about their circumstances. And they were articulate and responded in kind.
Very
so
well.
That was one of the highlights. And, of course, they were so over the moon about it, you know. They never thought they would meet a prince.
It's a prince.
Yeah, so they were very happy about that. So that was one of the highlights of my year.
Okay, great. Well, Madam First Lady, I'd like to congratulate you on all the work that you're doing, and I know that you will continue to do those works, of course, facing them. And you, by now, you're also part of the Facing the Nation family. Viewers, this is also a big cheer and a support, and she is never afraid to say how she feels or what you should do or what you should not do in a very loving way, I must add. So I'd like to take this opportunity to once again congratulate you and your office, and thank you very much for coming on.
Thank you very much, Malika. It's always a pleasure.
All right.
And I'm very happy to share what I'm doing with the people of Guyana.
Wonderful.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Of course, the viewers, if you're now tuning in, you missed a great conversation. As usual, those of you who follow me on social media, you can catch this conversation a little later on in the day on YouTube, and it will also be on Facebook. So my conversation would have been with the First Lady of the Cooperative Republic of Guyana, Her Excellency Mrs. Sandra Granger. What I'll do now is ask the operator to pull up the press conference held by the Attorney General and Minister of Legal Affairs earlier today, the Honorable Basil Williams. Of course, I did point out earlier that it was a lot that he touched on, a lot of the issues, a lot of current issues. So what we'll do is have you view that press conference, and by the time I get back, it will be time to wrap today's program. This is Facing the Nation.